I'm Holly Tucker, and welcome to my podcast, Conversations of Inspiration. Founder of Not on the High Street and Holly & Co., I'm the UK ambassador of creative small businesses. I believe that having a business doing what you love is the key to a happy, fulfilled life, and my dream is to help everyone start theirs. I'm here to offer advice, inspiration, wisdom, and encouragement. And in my view, the greatest way to do this is by sharing stories. So I've reached out to all my favourite small businesses, acclaimed entrepreneurs, and those who just simply inspire me, and asked them to share theirs. With thanks to our sponsor, NatWest, who have helped bring this free podcast to life. Here are my conversations of inspiration.
Bow your head and let your eyelids close on down.
In this week's conversation of inspiration, I'm speaking to Bill Collison, founder of Bill's Restaurants. Born and bred in Lewes in East Sussex, Bill started work by growing and harvesting fruit and veg with his family. One day he received an offer of a small shed by his father to make of it what he wished. So he started selling the families and local farmers fruit and veg, which soon turned into a greengrocer's shop, but not any greengrocer's, the most beautiful greengrocer's in town. When the flood hit Lewes, Bill was forced to reassess his plans, and on the advice of his sister-in-law, he decided to start a cafe as well, selling edible creations from all of his produce. The food was seasonal, inspirational, and ahead of its time. Bill put fruit on the pizzas, added roots and sprouts onto salads, and created extraordinary show-stopping cakes, which meant there was always a queue to get in. Bill then went on to launch another restaurant in Brighton and took investment to grow into the 80 nationwide locations it has today, the family of restaurants. I was thrilled to meet Billy, as his mother called him, in his head offices in London, where we chatted about the early days of Bill's, his passion for vegetables and visual merchandising with them, and the importance of retail theatre in order to grow a successful high street presence. So happy to be here, Bill. I'm the biggest Bill's fan and really admire what you have built. So, hello.
Hi. Thank you for having me.
Oh, no, thank you for having me. We have a Bill's in Richmond and the halloumi burger are just too good, actually. We often pop there, myself and my family, after the cinema because it's just on the hill and it's right next to the cinema. And we always have such a warm welcome. I've always admired the brand. I can remember years ago now, my team at Not on the High Street were always telling me to go to this amazing cafe in Brighton called Bill's. And so I took a trip there one day with my sister and we were completely blown away. First of all, I'd never seen actually anything like it. Your displays, the fresh produce, the walls adorned with tins of olives, the attention to detail everywhere. And I have to admit, I didn't know too much actually about the Bill behind Bill's before doing lots of stalking and researching. And I just think I've actually fallen a little bit in love with you. So I just wanted to put that out just straight away on this podcast because I can't wait to hear your wonderful story firsthand. So just jumping right in, I'd love to kick off hearing your story, how Bill's came about. And if we can go right back, is it true you were originally a barrow boy from Lewes?
My family were Romany gypsies. And so we used to travel the countryside through the summer and spring and autumn mostly, planting, pruning, picking fruit, lots in Kent and in Sussex. And so my family were really growers. My father bought a small fruit farm outside of Lewes, which is now a garden centre, but it had a nursery, quite a lot of glass houses and vegetables, fruit trees. And I grew up on that fruit farm and it was like a summer haze. It was a fabulous place to live. Amazing friends and memories I've got from that time. I actually liked it, but hated it. I didn't realise then if you liked something more than you hated it a little bit, it was okay to be in it. And it wasn't very glamorous at the time. And my father, he made me go and plant the tomatoes and pick them. And I had to work when I was not schooling. It's a credit to him now, because I love those memories so much. The smell of the potting sheds, the packing of the tomatoes, the big loaf and the cheese sandwiches at lunchtimes, and big mugs of tea with all the other workers on the farm. I'd love to turn back the clock and be in that potting shed now, but those days are gone. But I went on to do a little bit of chefing. I had always had a bit of a passion for food and liked cooking, thought I could chef. And again, I got slightly bored with that and took the easy option, went back to work for my father. And he happened to turn up and have this little space in Lewes, which was really no more than a barrow. And he said, go and do something with that. And I did. I opened up this fresh produce sort of store, come shed, come site. But it was all with local produce. I knew the local growers, and it was all about local produce and what was in season. And we worked there and was very successful. And my Saturday girl was working for me, and she turned out to be my wife in the end. And
oh, goodness.
What happened was, her sister was in the restaurant industry, and she said, what you're doing with this, it looks amazing. The way you make things look amazing. And we'd already started turning things that were left over into pies and tarts and soups, so something got on the wheel and it got off somewhere. And she said, we should open a cafe, a restaurant here, in amongst what you do. People would love it. And I thought it was a bit bonkers. And she convinced me, and we went and saw other things, and we thought, well, what we're doing is a lot better than this, or different. And just then, when we were trying to get more space, a massive flood hit Lewes, and my home was wiped out, the shop was wiped out, all the delicatessen area was wiped out of the business. It sort of knocked us for six, really, and the following day, we had no money, so I set up a market stall on dry ground and started working straight away. But what it did allow us to do was to take some more space, and we managed to claw our way back. And we opened up this bigger site with a cafe in it. And with my sister-in-law, Tanya, Rebecca worked there. We all worked together. Even my mother-in-law worked in there. It was just one big family working together. I looked after the fresh. She looked after the... I mean, I'm not very good at the business side of things, I must say. But I can put on a show. And we made this look amazing. It did look amazing. I used to go in there in the mornings and start work at 3 or 4 o'clock to create this look. And that could be leeks with daffodils coming out of vases and delphiniums coming out of cakes. It was just a wild show. And whatever was in season would be what we had there. And we used to take tables up, which customers would be on, because there was a lorry load of Victoria plums arrived outside, and we put plums on seats rather than bums on seats. It wasn't done anything. It wasn't really commercial. But it was done to make everyone go, wow. And I used to walk out of there in the mornings. The last job we used to do was wash the street down from 100 yards that way, and walk back in. And it used to make the hair stand on the back of my neck, looking back in at it. And the compliment was the guests used to, they couldn't get a table because it was too busy, but they used to come just to look. There would always be music on. There would be a band playing outside at the weekends. It was just one great big piece of entertainment. And we were very lucky, and we were in the right place at the right time. And three or four people that were very hardworking, lots of different talents amongst them, loved each other, still do, and worked together. Now, I'm not sure anyone could put them, everyone, I get all the praise, they don't really, but really,
it was
a team effort that made it.
A
family team that made it, yeah. Then we went on to open Brighton. That took us 5 years before we decided we were going to do that. We were going to do it next week when we opened Lewes, but it took us 5 years to sort it out. And from day one, that was an instant success. Won a few awards, queues out the door. Every day was, an amazing team of people. That very talented. Very talented head chef who was really amazing with pastry, who worked for us, and amazing with different flavours, and definitely worked really well with me. I mean, I used to have a joy to go and get him something that was unusual, and he really responded to that. And we were sort of courted for a long period of time by different investors. But those days were amazing. My wife says to me, you never used to come home. I used to just love being there. It wasn't any hardship to go get up as soon as you woke up. It could be the middle of the night and go to work because you wanted to put on... It's almost like painting every day. You were putting on a show.
I wish I could go back, actually, to 2000 and step inside your very first Bill's and Lewes. It sounds like a completely magical place. First of all, Lewes is that most beautiful independent town, but I love the vision of these customers sitting amongst your vegetable displays. And I think actually it would have been an Instagram extravaganza if social media had been around. You would have had just all phones, wouldn't you, all out. And I know you were saying in time that actually people did take photographs of your products, but actually probably with real cameras at the time. I wanted to give listeners a sense of what it must have been like. And I know you would probably be too modest to go here. So I've found a description written by a lady called Angela Wintle for Sussex Life magazine. And I just thought I'd read it out. I'll never forget the first time I walked into Bill's in Lewes. It was a show-stopping moment. And how often can you say that about a grocer's shop? You could spot it from 20 paces. The pavement overflowing with fruit, the signs declaring Kentish corn on the cob, 5 for 50p. Inside was foodie's paradise, leeks displayed with daffodils, hanging dried peppers and shelves of own brand juices and olive oil, not to mention a counter of film set puddings. Up in the rafters, rustic wire baskets hung from butcher's hooks beside rainbow-coloured raffia. Sometimes I'd walk in just to drink in the spectacle, though I'd rarely left without clutching one of Bill's mouth-watering homemade quiches. But Bill's, of course, was always much more than a fruit and veg shop. He ran a cafe too, and the cafe became so popular, it quickly gobbled up the shop and the premises next door to become the biggest thing in town. What a way of describing something that you created. And the thoughts of daffodils and leeks makes me go completely funny, because that is something that, you know, you just don't see. And I absolutely admire that attention. Where did that passion and creativity, that flair for aesthetics, come from? You spoke about your parents, but was it in school? Was there an influence when you were growing up?
I always remember when in the packing sheds, picking tomatoes and making sure, even back in those days when no one ever heard of a vine tomato, I'd cut them so they were on the vine. I'd go to the packing shed and I wanted my palette to look the best looking palette that left there and be the best one in the market that was sold. And I used to do it then with tissue paper, different coloured papers underneath the tomatoes. I know that I had a definite skill and I enjoy it. It's not if it was any hardship. I knew that I could almost design with fruit. I could feel that. And I had this ability to make something, give it a layer. Mm-hmm. So you look through something and it had a depth and had a meaning. Some of it could only make you laugh. Some of it wasn't beautiful, but it almost put a picture in front of you, whether you're using terracotta or bring props that made a show that was going on there. Yeah, I didn't find it hard. I enjoyed it.
And so it literally came from, in another scenario that could have been because I had gone to art school or I had done something. You're sitting in the potting.
My father, I can definitely feel I got something from my father was very clever at those. He had an eye for those things as well, whether I inherited something.
But that idea of wanting to make that box of tomatoes more than a box of tomatoes, that just came from within you.
Yeah, I mean, I wanted it to be the best one there. And it's colours. Fresh has got so many different colours. I mean, they amaze me. It still amazes me who made the pear with a blush on it. You know, where does a plume on a plum come from? There's so many beautiful things out there. I remember going to markets and being in Covent Garden with my father when we were younger. There's just something about it all. There's just the fresh and farming, you know, there's just something about that.
And you definitely followed your passion from growing, for producing, for cooking. And I think that's just incredibly inspiring that you did follow that journey. What would be your advice to others?
I didn't think I knew what journey I was going to follow. So, and you can always look backwards and say, yeah, we did that or we didn't do that. I never knew at that time that's what I wanted to do. I said earlier that I think sometimes the good times outweigh the bad times. That's good enough. But I think if you have got a passion, you're very lucky. I mean, I never knew what I wanted to do. I wasn't looking for something better, but I never knew what I wanted to do. And I looked to the future and thought, well, I've got loads of time to sort that out. I've not got to worry. And that come from the support from my family. There was no one saying, you've got to do this, you've got to. There wasn't any pressure on me. You know, I was very lucky and blessed.
Now you've lived a career in your passion, and there's so many people around us who don't. What would your advice be to people?
I think you have to take a chance. You have to, especially when you're young, you know, there's always time for change. It says you get older, there's not time for change. There's always time to change. There's always time to make a mistake. It's good to make the mistake. You don't make enough mistakes, then you never learn anything, do you? So I think always try different things. And it doesn't have to always be about pounds, shillings and pence. You know, if you're good at something, and normally one thing leads to the other. You know, if you're really good and you're passionate about something, you'll be successful. And you go the extra mile if you love what you're doing, don't you? And everyone wants to see someone do a little bit more. And I always find the harder you try, then the more support you get from everyone. People can see you're passionate about things and people can see your honesty then, you know.
They want to give you a helping hand.
They do. People want to help you. I really believe they want to help you. But as a business, as my business grew, you go away from your passion a little bit, which I'm sure we'll talk about. Yeah. And, you know, and sort of getting knees deep in something that's not quite where you want it to be, that sometimes needs reigniting. You can do that for yourself sometimes. Sometimes you need someone else to do that for you. Sometimes there's a need financially to do that, but for lots of different reasons.
I couldn't agree more. You have an attention to detail, which is something so common, I think, in successful entrepreneurs. You know, understanding that detail actually is everything when it comes to building a strong brand. Is it true that you only have one person who's allowed to do the chalkboard signage?
Actually, she's left us now because my sister-in-law's opened something in Kemp Town called Marmalade, and it's a lovely cafe and she's very good at what she does. But Lou Carter used to work for me. She used to do all the sign writing. And we have now have sign writing competitions to see who can get nearest
to
Lou Carter.
The legacy that was left.
But
there.
She just had that flow of making sure, just idyllic, you know, sort of handwriting.
It's what I absolutely love most about Bill's and yourself is the way that you see running your restaurant is this, you've already alluded to it, putting on a show. I've heard you say it a couple of times. You really remind me of one of my design heroes, Henry Selfridge, because he understood the importance of retail theatre. He used to have a trumpeter who used to sound the fanfare at 9 o'clock every morning when the store opened and prep the staff all to be ready for their best performance. And he created the magnificent experience in store and was one of the first people to introduce window displays in Britain. Apparently, he even coined the phrase, the customer is always right. I think that's basically you in a nutshell reincarnated. It's why you were so successful from day one. People loves Bill and Bill's because it was totally a unique experience. Is this a philosophy you believe in, that to be successful, you must have an element of putting on a show?
I believe so. We call it on stage, off stage. So for the team I work in each restaurant, they're on stage. They're actors. They're part of theatre. You know, the guests are your audience, and actually the guests take part. And we try to tell them that when things go wrong, which they will, that's your time to ad lib. That's when your audience love you the most.
What
is when
brilliant
you
way of looking at
when
it.
You when someone sing forgets their lines and you sing a different line. That's when you get the biggest applause. Yeah, so it is about putting on that show. I mean, we talk about it all the time, putting on a show. This is theatre, you know. This is your stage. There's so many different things that you have to do to put on a show. And I think retail, it's been easy for people to be mediocre. And time's got harder now, and you need to try harder. You need to work harder. You need to do all the things that make you different from everyone else and set you apart and raise your game and sing louder, talk about yourself more in some ways, but do it not by screaming yourself, but what you do in the restaurants, the way you make it look, everything, little touch points, the things that excite people, make people laugh. I find it a moment now where, although there's problems on the high street, and it's the moment for people to grasp and really themselves above everyone else, you know, because while other people are cutting and worrying, you need to make yourself better and then you'll survive. You know, give the guests more, better food, better service, a better look and feel. So you give them more than they perceive they're going to get in the first place.
I wanted to interrupt this podcast with such exciting news for the small business community. We're running a competition over the next 10 weeks for a chance to win an ad break on this very podcast, Conversations of Inspiration. NatWest, who we partner with, have donated their very own ad break space as they wanted to give it to small businesses in order to help their dreams succeed. It's this generosity that makes NatWest our partner. Each week, one small business will get their advert played in the middle of the latest episode of Conversations of Inspiration for tens of thousands of people to hear that week, but hundreds of thousands of people to listen to when it reaches our podcast library. I'll be looking for the most creative, interesting adverts to feature. We'd love to hear from the founders with perhaps an anecdote about what your small business means to you, what you do, what you create. You might want to share the story of why you started your business. Just remember, it needs to be under 2 minutes. Whilst we're looking for good quality ads, don't worry, you don't need any fancy equipment. You can record your well thought through adverts straight into your phone and email us at independentadbreaks@holly.co. Head to my website, holly.co, or my Instagram to find out more. Don't miss this utterly brilliant and free opportunity to broadcast your small business to thousands of listeners, thanks to our partner, NatWest. Good luck. Tell me about if someone listening wants to create theatre within what they do. I know you don't have a manuscript on to create theatre, step A is this, but what are those things that you needed inside yourself? Is it about self-belief, just going for it, making mistakes?
I think you've got to believe in what you do. I think you've got to be positive. I think you've got to be fun. And I don't mean just fun to your guests. I think you've got to be fun to everyone around you, staff-wise. I think they've got to be really proud of where they're working. I think you've got to want to be there yourself. You've got to really believe in it. If you don't and your team don't, then what chance have you got a guest to make yourself any different than anyone else? The dangers are if it's something's not working well or something, then you change it too quickly. So that doesn't mean to say you can't learn from your mistakes. But I think you've got to give things longevity and let it take its course. We have definitely made mistakes. I mean, there's not been one smooth ride forward and there we go, guys, we're here now. 80-odd restaurants later, we're not. We've made loads of mistakes. And we've sometimes forgotten things we should have been doing. But it doesn't mean to say we can't put them right now, does it?
No.
And as I say, you've got to make it different. You've got to make yourself look different. You've got to make yourself feel different. You've got to give a better service. I always felt they're walking into a film set. They're walking to something that, I mean, my guys, my partners tell me I'm sales adverse because I make things look so beautiful, no one wants to touch them to buy them. And they say, oh, God, we can't touch that because, you know, and so we actually didn't sell that much, but it looked good, you know.
Yeah,
so, but it sort of built the foundation,
yeah.
You know, and we never sold a lot of fresh produce, but it was our larder. It was a larder for the kitchen, which we did sell lots of, and the guests got to see it. They got to touch it.
You just mentioned there that, you know, maybe giving something some time. I thought that was quite interesting. So just to go, just to carry on that. So you might start something or when you were building bills and it doesn't kick off instantly.
No.
And people want to throw it away. You know, you're scared, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, this isn't instantly working. The sales aren't coming in. We must change it. Do you believe in having faith in
yeah, I do.
Because actually, I certainly felt it through Not in the High Street and Holly & Co. Have faith. You know, hold on. Hold your nerve, because actually that could be the foundations of your brand being built just there.
Well, I think if you change shop, you dilute what you've done in the first place. We definitely had to hold our nerve. We were busy, but we didn't make any money. It took us a long time to work out how exactly we could be profitable and still be busy. And people couldn't believe there'd be queues out the door and still we didn't make any money. And it was just putting things in order, you know, whether it be rotors right the way through. It's all those small little finely tuned details that make all the difference.
Pockets of money wherever.
Yeah, yeah.
When you pull it all together.
Yeah, you know, and also making sure everything gets on that wheel and gets off at the right time to look after itself in the right manner.
This engagement you had with the community in Lewes, or being at the heart of Lewes, was that important to you? And is it then now important to Bill's?
I for 20 years, I never... If you know Lewes, there's a humpback bridge.
Yes.
You've got Harvey's and Bill's there.
Yes.
I lived in that same street. And I think for 20 years, I didn't go over that humpback bridge. I lived in that community. I mean, we'd go on holiday for a week of the year, you know, and we lived and breathed. We went to the local pub and, you know, we didn't do anything really, only work. And yeah, we were part... I mean, I was born and bred in that in Lewes. And we were part of the community. Bill's looked after the community. But really, actually, the community looked after Bill's. And they thought of it as theirs and still do. Mm. Which is an amazing thing.
And when we,
you know, obviously, we've gone... It's changed. But for all the time, they've definitely supported us. And we never sold Coca-Cola, we never sold fries in Bill's, and, you know, it was a different thing. And Lewes and Brighton were quite bohemian, and there was a more majority of that type of people there, and it worked quite well. I'm not sure that it would work everywhere, you know, so we're community-based, supporting their communities, which we always do. I mean, if someone turns up and there's a garden fete on, Bill's would sponsor it. We've always done it.
And there's such a position, isn't there? You know, you have 80 establishments for that, in a way, to then start to become more than a restaurant.
But I really don't want to be seen as a chain restaurant, because it's not like that at all. You know, everyone who works here has got a soul. It's like a big family in some ways, you know. But... Mm-hmm. It's more than just, there's more going on there. There's a fire in this business's belly that's glowing.
And I love how you don't call it a chain, you call it a family of restaurants. You know, that just says it all in a way, doesn't it? That you
it
don't
does,
look
but you,
at it.
We need to make sure that every day we're living up to those things that we keep talking we want to be. And I think you have to keep setting your goals a bit higher and keep pushing them up. And what happens, is that you make things easier for yourself. And every time you make something easier for yourself, the customer, the guest loses out somewhere. And you can't help but do that. And I think you have to now make things harder for yourself. And of course, in turn, the guests get more.
Isn't that interesting? Gosh, yes, we all look for that quick fix, don't we all? Or, you know, we can cut something here and it does make the system better. But actually, you're right. What that end user then experiences,
one
is it actually
okay,
better?
That's not going to make you bleed. But when you get two or three, you don't know which one's making, you don't know which one to cover up first. So you make sure you don't keep making those decisions.
Well, it's very interesting you were talking about this and community. One of my missions is to help try and restore the high street to the wonderful thing it used to be, retaining its position as the heart of the community, the shopkeepers being the stars of the show, making locals feel connected with one another. And touching on the future of the high street, we're constantly hearing about the death of the high street. And I was recently speaking to Henry Dimbleby, founder of Leon, for this podcast, and he was talking about the hard times that casual dining sector is actually going through. Closures of Jamie's and Carluccio's, Prezzo's, GBK, and Deliveroo is outperforming. For me, I think it confirms that you need to give customers this experience, this theatre. I'm interested to ask, what do you think is the future of restaurants in the high street, and actually retail for that matter? I know that's quite a big question. And what do you think is going wrong?
Well, obviously, there's oversaturation, so there's more restaurants out there than what's needed. Supermarkets are doing meals for the weekend for very low cost. Delivery can bring anything to your door, but none of those can do the thing that you're speaking. They can't give you an experience. They can't give you a show. They can't put you in that film set so you're part of it. And that's what we need to do, whether it be, I think, the butcher with the grill outside grilling the local sausages every day to go in a bun, you know, or the fishmonger doing something different. You know, listen, you go to the farmer's market and they're packed with people. The people want to eat and they want to be seen there. They want to fill their bags with the shopping. The high streets need to get back to that. Landlords have got to pull their belt in. They've got to make it accessible for startups to get in there. We know how creative we are. To me, it's all led by food. If we can...
The high street.
It's going to be led by food. It's where you shop, local community, shopping every day rather than going out once a week. It's about having a local shopkeeper can deliver to you if you're at work, putting your orders in. It's just going back in time slightly. Mm-hmm. And restaurants the same. It's just giving that bit better service than what we have done.
And almost technology supporting that right now.
Yeah, yeah.
You can use technology to help all of those things.
Yeah, of course.
But actually it is about remembering, you know, I always say until we've got the chip in our minds and we're all living in a virtual world, we're all going to want to do something at the weekends. We want to spend time with our children. We want to actually get out of our homes. And if that high street goes, if that place that we all join together starts disappearing, I think we're a bit of we're asleep at the wheel, really. And we need to sort of wake up to that. And actually that does need then the community to realise that they play a vital part in that. So, you know, as we're on this tipping balance,
on the tipping balance. I think people are realising it. I think my children, they go out, they want to be seen. They want to go to exciting places. They want to go to unusual street markets. They want to try different food. They want to be out. They want to Instagram from where they were on Sunday to their friends. I do.
So that's interesting. Yeah, so maybe that is actually happening. We've just got to create those places for them
exactly.
to go.
Look what's doing well. And they're the ones giving the theatre. Look what's... where you can go and just get a little bit more than you perceive you're going to get.
And what do you think, what's your future with Bill's in terms of the next 20 years? So you've done this journey. Are you as fired up for the next part?
It's really weird because the question you asked me before we started, which I'll answer, is that, yeah, I am actually. It's the closest I've come to feeling since I opened my first restaurant is in the last 8 months. It's surprising how quickly you can make things happen. And
why have you felt this? So tell me about what's this?
Well, just going back into the restaurants, which, you know, were successful and growing, opening very quickly, which we opened too quickly probably, and going back into them and giving a new lease of life, just to do something different, to try different things. And we're going to keep doing that. And no restaurant will be the same. Everyone's got its little soul, different area. Same morals, same infrastructure,
values,
same values,
food.
All those same... Yep. Not the same food, you know. It's different things going on. Having fun, making it exciting.
And that's brought back a
definitely,
joy.
Definitely, definitely. Those things when you put your head on the pillow at night and, you know, you start thinking about it and it gets you excited and so you can't sleep. There's one of the other thing we gets you down because you're worried about something, but there's the other one where you...
Yes.
You're excited about doing something. It's definitely been like that. Definitely.
And why do you think that had left?
I think it didn't leave me. I still felt a love for everything at Bill's, and I knew we still had a great team. But it just, you know, it just got some grey areas, which I know now we've come out of.
And coming out of it, almost it sounds like you're tasting what you did that many years ago again, feeling that you're able to get in control of it and drive it forward. And
I'm
watching
not
the reactions. You were saying that they're already, you know, people are loving them. And actually, that must be so rewarding.
Well, there's nothing nicer than sitting in something that you've created or with your team you've created. And seeing people enjoy what's going on and see them come back for more and almost applaud for what you've done. It's an amazing experience, you know. And I think I actually, when I first started Bills, when we first started Bills, it wasn't about how much money we were going to make. It was all about how can we make this exciting for ourselves and our guests. And mm-hmm. I think one thing leads to the other, I don't know. But I've never got out of bed and thought, how much money are you going to make? It's all about how well you can do something mm-hmm. and how you can... It's all a bit of vanity involved in it as well. You want people to say, that is amazing. That looks amazing.
Yeah, give you your gold star.
Exactly, that's all you want.
Because you've been up since 4 a.m.
Yeah, yeah. But you do want that praise. And yeah. I'm definitely one of those people that do.
So you've had this incredible career creating this family of restaurants and all the people that you must have hired and the family that you've created. A lot of small businesses listen to this podcast. So if you're thinking that you are that small business, thinking of starting up a cafe, starting up a restaurant, would you say go for it in this era? I mean, is it a good time? What would those pieces of advice be?
I think you've got to make sure you've got something that's different. And when I say different, it doesn't have to be something that's wild and different. I think you've got to make sure you're doing something better than someone else. It's still commerce. It has to be just something else going on. I think you just start something now. I think you have to have some sort of soul or heritage to what you do. And then consistency. It's all about consistency, doing it good, 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 better, better, better.
And how did you find that? I'd
say the same things over and over and over again. But when I had one restaurant, I thought I was the only one that could, I would be there. Do you know what? When we first joined up, when it took investment in, I used to go, they said, well, don't come in, so let someone else do it. And I used to go in before people were there to make it all get ready for them, so I knew that it would be okay. So
it's like when you clean, if you have a clean cleaner, before clean the cleaner. Before the cleaner.
Clean before the cleaner, yeah, I was a bit like that. And I used to think I was the only one that could make the coleslaw, only one can do that. And I realised that everyone can do things a lot better than I can most of the time. It just,
is that what you found, going, actually? Well, Has that been comforting to know that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's taken me a long time to work that one out, mind you, but I definitely think there's people...
But when you got to that point, yeah. It's like, oh, if only had known.
Yeah, well, and also not to steal anyone else's thunder. You know, even if they can't quite do it as well as you, it's not... You don't have to tell them that, you know, just encourage.
That's a good piece. You've heard that here first. Yeah. I'd like to also, there's something about scaling the unique. It's something I spoke about at Not in the High Street, which was, you know, how do you take your unique brand and you need to make it a successful company. What's that experience been like? You know, you have a high attention to detail. You said wearing a dirty tie whilst wearing a lovely suit. I just thought that was absolutely brilliant. You know, there you are in your lovely suit, but all anyone can look at is the dirty tie.
That's almost what led me to take the fresh out of everywhere on for sale. If something's not looking well, then it looks bad, you know, and it makes everything else look... It's unachievable for people to do it. And it took me a long time to transfer love to two or three different places. I couldn't make myself be there and there and there and in one go.
And have there been other things that you found hard to scale?
It's all about people.
Because you must have employed...
There's a lot of staff at Bill's,
And how what's your...
I think it's about 3,000, you know, and they've come and gone. Some of my dearest friends work for other people now and they used to work for us. So people move on. Obviously, you can't give promotions to everyone, so they go and get a promotion somewhere else. Time moves on, but you normally find where there's really good managers, good stable teams, they're phenomenal restaurants.
So comes from the people.
It comes from the people.
And what's been have you found common denominators? Has it been the sense of sharing of value or...
I'm trying to think now. Obviously, people work for me for a long time. The gym in Lewes Alley's worked for me since when we just had the veg... Just a veg barrow. So she's been like 30 years, I think. And so passionate about fresh, passionate about people, cares for what the reputation where she works. And I think that stems from the heritage. And that's why I said to you, Beth, if you've got a startup now, if you've got a heritage and a foundation there, a little bit more. then I think that helps.
I love to hear that you've got people around you that have been here for so long. I think when you have a successful entrepreneurial business and it's gone on for this long, you know, you've been to have that sort of tightness of family, almost your work family around you, yeah, that have seen the ups and seen the downs, that can actually support you going,
you know,
through
this journey. They've seen me angry, they've seen me sad, they've seen me so happy, they've seen us all at our worst moments, you know, and they've forgiven, they've forgotten, and they do definitely care for us, definitely.
I heard you say that one of the reasons that you took an investment was in order to see your family more. Did that work? The controlness of a founder, how did you feel about letting go some control?
There's this thing where you can, you know, there's nothing wrong with staying small. There's nothing wrong with, you know, but we chose at that time to take on investment, and with that investment meant that I would have a more secure future. By doing that, it allowed me to, after a while, to say I can pass some of that responsibility over. We are lucky to be in the place we're in, and as a personally, I've been blessed and very lucky to have the support of a team of my family and the team around us here, my investors, which have been, you know, very supportive the whole time, and, you know, and only want the best for Bill's. They really want Bill's to be the best thing out there. And some are involved with food, some are involved with just the business side of things, and they all push hard to make it the best it possibly can.
I couldn't not talk to you about vegetables and food specifically. You released your own cookbook called Cook, Eat, Smile. And inside...
It's a while ago now, but...
Yeah, and inside there's wonderful photos of you in your garden. And my favourite one is where you have a pumpkin on your head. Do you still garden? Are you still out there?
Yeah, I am. And it's funny, the publisher of the book turned up on the day of the photo shoot and she said, this is like a film set. If you know, from the cobwebs on the runner beans to the pumpkins and everything, she said it's just like a film set. And the garden was a bit like, you couldn't cut it. You know, you had to, it was there for looking at, not for cutting.
Yes, yes. And so and that obviously was your home, was it?
Yeah.
Hence why your properties look the way that they do, that it really is your style, your...
Yeah, I don't get so much time to do that now, I must say, and that's one thing I want to try and do. I want to grow more. I want to get back to that, you know, I want to get more involved with fresh, and I think Bill's can be part of that as well, so.
Do you have any future plans, opening another market stall in the future? I think the world is seriously missing daffodils and leeks.
Leeks together, yeah, very Welsh mix. I think there'll be a lot more fresh going on in Bill's. I think we are definitely... I'd like to do another, the most amazing fresh produce store, and perhaps we'll do some pop-ups. I'm thinking of actually when we're doing a little makeover of Lewes, doing some work in Lewes in not near future, quite near future. So we'll definitely do some stuff there to take it back to as it was for a while.
I'll be there to see it firsthand. Well, thank you, Bill, for restoring my faith in being obsessed about detail, giving me food for thought, excuse the pun, and just the way that you look at things, you know, for a lot of small businesses who are creative. And I actually just think just hearing about the leeks and the daffodils and hearing about the obsession of detail or taking that produce and going and cooking with it, and that you had these real fundamental beliefs in your brand, be it that you didn't make any money at the beginning, but you kept with it.
Yeah.
And now we get to all experience Bills all over the country because you have that faith in it. And I think it will really help people to hear that you held on, you held your nerve. Can I ask, in these interviews, I use the analogy of running your own business as like being on a absolutely crazy roller coaster. Can I just ask you, what would you say has been your biggest high so far?
Lots of little ones.
Yes.
Some really big ones, but little ones compared to this. But that first day when we opened up Bill's in Lewes, where we're as a team, and I had my two sons there, and they were young, but one was old enough to know what was going on. My wife, my sister-in-law, my mother and all the people I loved around me part of that. And for them to see and feel their joy as much as my joy was definitely the biggest high. And, you know, and I can still remember the music that was on. I can remember the people, the builders that were there. I can remember just looking at it and seeing, God, this looks so beautiful. And I'm being so proud of everyone that was part of it. And, you know, I still feel those joys. When I opened Soho not so long ago and your investor says, that looks cool, thumbs up to you. And I can tell myself it looks, you know, they're all little highs, but that was the biggest one.
And then the lows, what would be your lowest low?
I think if I had all my time, my lowest low would be that my mum and dad did never see that. And they died, I mean, months before that happened, you know, so, which was quite a big low. But as again, there's lots of little lows, but those little lows, I'm never very low for very long. I always try and see a silver cloud somewhere through it. And if I ever get low, I tell my wife and she always said, puts a boot on my bum and tells me that you're stupid there. And you're lucky.
She's
we
known
are.
You a long time.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, she definitely would put me in my place.
I'm also asking if you could recommend a future guest for this podcast. Who is someone that has inspired you or you think might inspire our listeners?
There would be quite a few, actually, from the long time ago. But I've got a good friend at the moment. He's a good friend for a while. Roger Wade, he's got Box Park. He's of the moment and he's doing it very well. He worked extremely hard. He makes a lot of mistakes that I think I would have made as well. He's very driven. He's, you know, he's good to talk to. Good to talk to him in a way that 90% of what he tells me, I listen to and I totally believe in. 10% I see myself saying 10 years ago, I think, you'll learn not to say that anymore. But definitely,
he's one to watch.
Definitely, I think he'd, well, yeah.
Thank you for that recommendation. It's been such a pleasure and I'm really looking forward to hearing your letter to yourself. But thank you, Bill, for sharing your story. And over to you.
My letter. Okay, this is a letter to myself. So, dear Billy, I write to you with a little advice from the highs and lows and ups and downs over the past 35 years. I start with your dreams. Always dream, never be afraid to follow them. Sometimes they may lead you to joy, sometimes despair and frustration. Learn from them and make the best of both, but let history be history. Try not to let it lead the future. There is no harm in standing still. Contentment comes in lots of ways. There is no harm in wanting less, but work hard whatever. Don't forget to have fun. Never underestimate the impact fun has on others. We all want to be around people enjoying life. Think lucky, act lucky, more likely to be it. Test yourself, try new things, take a chance. Try hard to be humble, sorry when wrong, but positive, strong and honest. Don't feel embarrassed to show your emotions. People will trust you for this. Thank your loved ones and friends for the care and help. Most success is due to their support. Be happy. Love, Bill.
Bill, thank you very, very much. Thank you. And I something I'll take away from that is be happy in staying still and be happy in almost understanding that moment and going through things, but not always having to build or grow, but actually just taking a moment to look at what you're exactly doing and actually appreciating it. And I very much appreciate sitting here with you today. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, NatWest, again for sponsoring this podcast. It's great to partner with an organisation that believes in empowering people in business. That's why they developed the NatWest Business Hub, which is full of information, tips and insights to help business owners meet their goals. Go to natwestbusinesshub.com to get started. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Conversations of Inspiration. I want as many people as possible to believe that they can build a business doing what they love. So could I ask a favour? If you like what you're listening to, would you rate, review and subscribe on iTunes, Spotify or your favourite podcast provider? It will help others find this podcast and may just be the inspiration they need to follow their dreams.
Bow your head and let your eyelids close on down. Where we're going, you won't need to bring your frown. You will find that all the things that I have said will come true when you are lying in your bed.